want to introduce you to what's known as a life cycle of ministry. And let me be quick to say there are many graphs like this. This is one that I like, and I'm not suggesting that one is better than the other. I'm just saying I want to introduce you to these graphs of life cycle of a ministry so you grab a hold of these concepts and begin to apply them to your church to see if they can help your church. So Robert Dale writes this. He's the one that created this life cycle. Ministries are born, they live, and some die, while others continue on. What are the cycles of a ministry, and what affects these cycles? So if you look at this graph on the left side, you see the number one, dreams. And then if you look down, the dream is a ministry begins as a result of the ministry of a dream. Someone has a vision, and they have vitality, and they want to start this ministry, which leads us to step two then. We move from dreams to objectives, where we begin to organize. And the leader and the people begin to talk about the mission and the purpose. And they're answering the question, why are we here? Why did God bring us together? Why did God want this church planted here? Which then leads us to number three, the values. And they begin to focus on unity, beliefs, and the camaraderie. And the main thing is that they have a belief system that comes from the Bible, and they have fellowship. They begin to enjoy one another. So the ministry starts with a dream. It's organized with some objectives. There are values that the group of people says, these will be our values. They set goals. And these are expectations that are the outgrowth of the dreams, the outgrowth of the objective, and the outgrowth of the values. And they're answering the question, what do we expect to happen here? Which leads us to number five. They get organized, and now there's a structure. It's a flexible skeleton, which is designed to hang all the programming and the ministry on it. And that structure is there to support the ministry. So it's not haphazard. It's not disorganized. It's very organized. We understand how every piece fits together. And out of that, now notice number six, ministry, and it has a plus sign behind it, which means it's a positive. A ministry is an outward orientation focused on serving and not being served. In other words, God didn't create this church. God didn't use us to create this church to serve ourselves. He created it for us to help one another grow so we could have an outreach into the community and see people come to faith in Christ, and then in some cases actually become leaders in the church. Now notice across the graph, number seven, ministry, but there's a negative spot behind that. And here's what begins to happen. Ministry begins focusing on the good old days. Ministry wants guarantees, not risks. It's more important to meet the needs of the members than to reach the lost. And we begin to focus on the past, what we used to do, and we begin to focus on ourselves. Let me tell you about a couple of churches with which I'm familiar. Actually, one of the churches, a church that I attended when I was a kid. I didn't want to be going to church, but my parents made me go to church, and my parents took me to church. But as I look back now, there was no training in the church. Services were only for ourselves. There was never any talk about touching our community for Christ. And over a period of time, the church became ingrown. The church began to worship the past instead of being motivated by vision, being motivated by seeing people come to Christ, and the church died. I know another church. It was a church of almost 2,000 people, but it had no goals. It had no direction. I know people who tried to help it, but the pastor was not interested and having any goals for the church, of seeing a future of what the church could become. And a few years ago, the church died. I know another church that had no care for its community. It had no idea of how many people lived in its community. It had no idea of the ethnic backgrounds in the community. And over a period of time, the church went from about 1,800 people down to 300, and it died and joined with another church. Why? Because the people began talking about the good old days. They began talking about what the church used to accomplish as though it was happening today. And there was no interest in seeing the community touched for Christ. So now, number eight, organization. The ministry now serves the organization rather than the organization serving the ministry. We are here for ourselves. Now think about that. If we weren't talking about church, but we were talking about a grocery store, but we didn't tell people that we were selling bread, then one day people wouldn't come to buy bread. And pretty soon we would not be selling any bread because we're not thinking about the community out there, what we can do to help other people. That leads us to number nine, questioning. There's a lack of future goals, and there are no questions about why we exist. Why are we here? There's no vision. There's lack of purpose because we don't continue to ask ourselves the question, why are we here? How are we doing? Are we being effective? That leads us to number 10. We're now polarized. People begin focusing in different directions and they come divided. The people become divided. And just as I got that telephone call one day from that woman saying, come and demonstrate against the store selling pornographic literature, this kind of a church then is polarized because there's no goal, there's no direction. People do whatever they want to do, and now the church in its focus becomes scattered, which leads to number 11, despair. It's almost dead. There's no vision. There's no vitality. There's no concern. And people are tired because there's no energy for the future. And finally, the church dies. And as Dr. Dale says, by the headstone, take the church to the graveyard. You see, it's all about leadership. Life cycles are about leadership. So let me encourage you today, if you are a pastor, take the time to use this graph or a graph like it and evaluate your church as to see where you are. If you're in the class as a seminary student and you are thinking about becoming a pastor, get a hold of these values that Dr. Dale describes so that when you start pastoring, you can say, where is this church right now? So you know what the church is doing, you know what the church is about, and you know how to continue to help the church move forward.
TVS Seminary is a nonprofit project. Our joint effort will bring about the common purpose of making Christian education available around the world and developing good Christian servant leaders. You have a unique opportunity to partner in this effort through your prayer and or financial support of TVS Ministry. For more information, please visit tvsseminary.com.
How does a church keep from descending down the negative side of the graph or the bell curve? Here's what he says. Go back to the basics. The current congregation must have faith, courage, and vision to dream new dreams. And that's difficult. Let me be honest about that. The current congregation must have faith, courage, and vision to dream new dreams. To evaluate what we're doing today, to evaluate and be honest, to answer the question, will these dreams carry us into the future? And what new dreams do we need to develop? These dreams must be translated into new statements of mission and purpose. Notice that, new statements of mission and purpose. What was effective in 1950 isn't necessarily effective in 1970, isn't effective in 1990, isn't effective in 2020, won't be effective in 2030. As a result of these dreams and goals, a flexible organizational structure must be put in place to handle the plans and the programming. But dreaming new dreams is risky business. Let me be honest about that. And if you're pastoring today and you realize that your church is beginning to diminish and you realize it needs to be infused with new dreams, as you begin to suggest new dreams, some are going to take that as a commentary on the past and they will resist. But that's what leadership is about. We must launch out by faith to achieve goals that might not always succeed. But new dreams could mean new approaches to worship, new people in leadership roles. Sometimes people get tired in leadership, or they get tired, but they don't want to say no to their position of influence. But we need to move them out of that position. Maybe there's a new Sunday school curriculum for education, or there's a new way to educate people in the Bible. There's a new ministry for a special segment of the population. Just like this church I mentioned a minute ago talked about, how do we help people in our community who are single parents? So they kept moving down the road saying, how do we help this group in our community? Maybe a new appearance in church construction or furnishings, new roles for the pastors and the staff, new fellowship groups, new structures, and the list goes on and on. In other words, we continue to say, God blessed us in the past. Why did he bless us? Is he blessing us today? And if we have a sense that he's not, then how do we create new ministries so he will continue to bless us? And so there's also a cycle here as you look at it. And here's what it looks like. If you look at the bottom of the arrow, we dream new dreams. And then there are objectives that we set. This is what we want to accomplish. And we have values. Then we set the goals. We now have a structure. And then we now have ministry. Now, let me say this. Evaluation, again, is vital work. It's not easy. Think of this today, if we were in a business together and we evaluated our business and we realized that not enough money is coming in to keep the business alive, we would say, what do we have to do to sell more products? Or imagine that we're here today and we're a group of farmers, or we're a group of ranchers, and we're talking about our fields that we plow and that we cultivate and we plant. And a couple of us say, my fields are not growing. I'm not growing as many crops as I used to grow. We would evaluate how we move that into the future. Now, let me just stop long enough to tell you, this is not in your notes, but a friend of mine, all the way back to when we were boys, about 14 years old, he went to a university, studied agriculture, and when he graduated from university, he was hired by our United States government to be what's known as a county supervisor. And he was given an area of land in the state where he lived, and he was made available to ranchers and farmers in that area. And he would help them know how to make their fields and their ranches more productive. And so some of us talked to him one day to say, how do you help ranchers when they have their own property, but you are an advisor? And here are a couple things he said, and it relates now to evaluating our church ministry. He said, people do not care how much you know until they know how much you care. So when I go to their ranch or their farm to introduce myself, I'm saying to them, I care. Now take that principle forward then back to the church. If I come to your church as a new pastor, or I come to your church as a consultant, or I come as your pastor with a new idea, I need to make certain, as my friend said, that I'm communicating, I care. Secondly, my friend said, I asked a lot of questions. When a rancher said, I want to improve this area, I want to improve this field, I would say, why? If the rancher would say, I think I can grow more grass here, I would say, why? Asking why showed that I cared and showed them that I would not recommend something without knowing their agenda. I connected with them on an emotional level. In other words, he was saying that these people knew that he cared for them. So as you think about that then, back in the church, the person with the new vision doesn't just come in and blow over people, but he or she is explaining that he cares and that he cares for the church, and we need to move forward with a sense of caring. My friend went on to say, I needed to know how many talents the rancher had as a manager. If he had a huge ranch, then he had to have other people working with him. Was he able to manage those people? It's the same in the church. If we want a church to grow, does the pastor have abilities as a leader and a manager to help place other people and encourage them to do the work of the ministry? And then my friend said, he would say to ranchers, I'm not here to tell you how to run your ranch, but to find refinements to improve your production. And then he said, building credibility took time with patience and build care incrementally. So as we think about that as it relates to the church then, we need to be sensitive to people. I'll talk more about that. We need to thank them for their ministry in the past and to help them know how to move into the future. My friend said it a different way. I took baby steps with ranchers and farmers. I took baby steps. And again, he didn't try to overwhelm them with all that he knew, but rather he would say, let's take this step by step. So let's take this back to the church for a moment then. How do we help a church grow? How do we help a church move forward? We affirm its past. We affirm the people who've worked in the past. Maybe the church is bigger than one they can lead right now. So we affirm them. We tell them we respect them. And then we say, how can we evaluate so that we are moving in the fullness of the power of the Holy Spirit into the future? We must remember that people do not like to admit fault. If a church begins to plateau or begins to decline, it's hard for people to admit that. So we need to be sensitive to them. We need to help them understand that this is Christ's church, not our church, and are our goals in line with Christ's goals for the church. So let me repeat, evaluation is not easy, but it's necessary. And sometimes what we find is that there are people in the church who are controlling, or we call them in the United States church bosses. They're not interested in growing a church. They're not interested in growing a ministry. They're interested in being in control. It's almost as though they have an addiction to control. And they will resist change if they think we're going to move them out of a position of authority, out of a position of leadership. And we need to work carefully around them because they do not want to give up the control they have. But the evaluation of a church is important. Knowing whether or not we have a cutting edge church is important. Knowing where we are on the life cycle is important. So it has to be done. And the good leader figures out how to tell the people we need to evaluate so we are setting goals for the future of this church. God bless you as you think about, is your church cutting edge? And as you think about yourself and how you can move that church forward.